PDI or SOAP or the structure. Okay, so I guess there is no doubt. So let us continue, right? We, as we said, in the SOAP message, we are embedding as much as information as possible so that the services do not have to maintain that information. And that is why we can make our services independent. We can make the services loosely coupled, and we can make them stateless, right? So, and in other words, you can say that services can become as generic as possible, right? So now let us take an example. Suppose you want to design a SOAP message, right, for invoice service, right? Now, when invoice is supposed to be sent, right, in the header portion, what are the things required? Can you give me some example based on this last slide that we have seen yesterday? When you are sending the invoice, what are the informations we require? Okay. Yes, WSDL is required. That is fine. Based on WSDL, we can generate the SOAP message. That is correct. But when you are generating the SOAP header of the invoice message, of the invoice itself, right? In the request message that you will be sending, what you will embed as a header information. Will you require the source and destination address? Right. Invoice will be sent to the accounting service, right? So the address of invoice service plus the address of account service, both are required. Okay. What else? Do I need to embed some correlation identifier to notify that this invoice is for a particular order? Because you might be sending multiple invoices. Are you getting this? Right? So we need to actually club, right? We need to actually club the invoice information, right? And it should also contain the identifier information regarding the order. Are you getting this? Invoice is pertaining to which order? So at least that order ID is required to be embedded. Yes or no? Okay, so can I say that that is correlation information? Correlation information, right? So that whenever the account service responds, it can respond that I have received invoice for this particular order. Are you following this scenario? Yes or no? Whenever account service replies, suppose I am embedding the ID as 123, right? So 123 was my order number. So whenever the account service replies, it will send the reply with the again ID 123 so that invoice service can identify that this reply is for the order number 123. Are you understanding this, right? So that is called correlation identifier, right? Now, will you be embedding that in the body portion? Do we need to write that information in body or it goes in header? That is the next question. Yes, this identifier information should be embedded as a SOAP header or as a SOAP body. What does your logic say? As per the rule, we say that it is going part of header, right? So is it correct? Yes or no? Right, so that example is given over here. Whenever you send the invoice via SOAP message, it should contain at least this much information. If you are not storing source and destination, in that case, it is fine, because if you are sending it directly to the account service, then destination information might not be required. But at least correlation information is required. Correlation will include the identifier of the order plus the date and time, right? So when the invoice was generated. So whenever the receiver, or you can say the account service, has to send the reply, right, it can know that it is sending reply to which order. It is sending reply to which order, okay? Other thing, we have to embed the information regarding the username and password, right? Because ultimately we have to focus on. Just a minute. Okay, so whenever you are accessing the web service on the other side, you have to embed the user ID and password, right? So that that service will allow you. Is that fine? Right? Is that clear to all? Okay. So anything else do you think that should be embedded, or this is sufficient? Yes, do we need to embed anything else, or this information is sufficient in the SOAP header? Are you all following this example, yes or no? Okay, sufficient, okay. Thank you for the reply, Janil. It is sufficient, definitely, right? Now, what will be going as a part of body? Can anyone tell me that? What will be going as a part of body when you are sending invoice? It is not a part of this slide, but I want you to... Okay, in a request message, Janil, in the request message, what you will be sending? When the invoice is being sent, what will be going as a part of request or the body portion? You will be sending the actual invoice details, or it can be URL of the invoice, right? As a parameter, yes or no? Right? So that will be part of body, right? Or you can also attach invoice as an attachment. That is also possible. That we have not seen yet, that I'm going to cover today. Fine. We can also have SOAP attachments where the data in its original format can be attached. Okay, so that part is left actually. So that is what we'll be starting with today. So that topic is known as SOAP attachment. SOAP attachment allows you to handle the data in its native format. Fine. So you don't have to convert that to XML. You can embed that document, right, with your SOAP message as an attachment. So either it can be an image file or a PDF file, right? So it is possible to attach that with your SOAP message. Are you able to understand this? Yes or no? If you can't convert your information in XML, be it or let it be as it is, right? So if a document, sometimes it is required that you have to digitally sign a document, right? Suppose it is, let us say, payment information. So that requires a sign of authority, right? So in that case, again, you can attach the digital signature as an attachment, okay? So that is also possible. So SOAP attachments allow you to attach two things. Either you can attach the file in its original format, or you can attach this digital signature, right, which is again encrypted, right? So this is one topic which we left from last class, right? Then what will happen if the message is delivered to someone else, right? Or what happens if the message is lost, right, or delivered after a long time, right? So for that, in the body portion, you have one more element that is known as SOAP fault in terms of XML, right? In the body portion itself, you can write this element, and inside this element, we can actually write the exception handling logic. That means in case of a false delivery, which service should be informed, right? Because ultimately, if someone else is receiving this message, right? And if they want to notify that this message is delivered by mistake to that service, so that kind of exception handling logic can be coded or can be written in case of SOAP fault section. Okay, so it can be used to send response in case of failure or missed delivery. Yes, Janil, that's a good question. See, in web service communication, we have point to star communication. Remember that? It is not point to point, right? So, inadvertently, what happens is, when the message is being passed, right, instead of going to the correct channel, it changes the channel, it goes to some other path, and it is getting delivered to some other receiver by mistake. This happens in network due to network errors. Are you getting this? Right? So that is why we can embed the fault information. So even if it is delivered by mistake to someone else, or if it is not delivered for a long time, then also some action can be taken. Fine. So that is called SOAP fault. So a SOAP message actually contains four major aspects: SOAP header, SOAP body, SOAP attachments, and SOAP faults. Are you all clear with this? Right? Yes, these are the four important elements of any SOAP message, right? That's what we have. Okay. Okay, fine. So let us now continue with the message style. So whenever we generate such bulky message, right? Why I'm saying bulky? Because we are going to have complex header information. We are going to have complex body information. You will be having attachments, right? You might also be having fault section, right? So that kind of message is actually called document style message, right? Now, there is a reason why it is called document style, because we are trying to embed so much information as if we are writing a document, right? So definitely the size of message will be large. What do you think? Size of the message is going to be large? Yes or no? As you are embedding lot of details, the size will be large or not? Yes? So that is why it is known as document style message, as if you are creating an XML document, right? Ultimately, it is an XML document only, right? But it is called a SOAP message, fine. Why it is document style? Because it contains large payload. That means it contains lot of data in the body portion, right? Coarser interface operation. Now, I'll clear out one concept over here. One concept is known as fine grain operation. The other concept is known as coarse grain operation, right? Fine grain means if your function is taking just an integer parameter, right? And the other cases, it is accepting an object. Okay. So which is more finer information? First or second? Or which is having less information, in other words? First function is taking integer parameter. Second function is taking an object as a parameter. Which function can be classified as a fine grain operation or fine operation? First or second? That takes integer, yes, right? Because coarse grain, coarse means it is a collection, right? When we are passing an object, right? We generally mean that it is a collection of information. So in SOA, we promote that you should be handling coarse grain operations. That is, most of your operations should be working with lot of data, not on individual data. Are you getting this? Yes or no? Right? Suppose you want to fetch employee information, right? So the employee information will be passed in form of object again, right? The response type of that message will be object. You will not be passing employee ID, name, object as individual messages, right? You are passing everything as an object. Are you following this? Right? Yes? So this is known as coarse interface operation, right? And why we are doing this kind of job? So that we can reduce message transmission volume. So I don't have to pass so many messages. I can pass messages one by, I can pass one huge message, right? So that I'm avoiding multiple small messages. Okay. So this is called document style messaging format. This is opposite to what we know as RPC style message. In earlier days, the architectures were using RPC style. You know what is RPC? RPC, what is the full form? Remote procedure call. Anyone has any idea regarding this? Right? Have you heard this name at least? Yes, right? So in case of RPC, we just call methods by individual parameters, right? So the operations are very fine-grained in that case, right? So what is the problem in that case? You have to call your operation multiple times if you want to fetch multiple details, right? Which is not actually good, because it will increase the amount of transmission of messages, right? Unnecessarily. So that's why in SOA we prefer document style messages. Clear with the difference? This can be asked in the interview, right? You should know what is document style message versus RPC style message. Are you fine with that? Yes. As a computer engineer, you should know these terms, right? Is it okay? Can we go ahead? Yes, yes. Okay. Fine. Now, let us now focus on the implementation part. That is, up till now, what we discussed is we said that services are sending the messages, right? But is that true? Can the service contain the logic of message generation? What do you think? Or should the service contain the logic of message generation? Service is just supposed to do what? It is supposed to provide the functionality. Ideally, message generation should be given to some other entity. Yes or no? Are you following this? There are two things we are having, right? One is service logic. The other is SOAP message. Now, what my question is, should I keep the logic or the service logic combined with SOAP message generation logic, or the SOAP message generation logic should be kept separate? Is the question clear? If it is clear, please answer. Yes. Okay. Last time when you coded that in lab, did you write any logic to send the SOAP message or to generate the SOAP message? Let me ask this question in the other way, right? So that I can get the answer. No, that is correct, right? What did we write just? Calculator operation? Add, update, subtract, and divide? Yes or no? Right? So then what do you think, or which entity generated this SOAP message? It was your .NET framework. It was WCF service framework, you can say, that generated the message. Are you getting this? Yes or no? Right? In service, we did not have the code of SOAP message generation. Right? It is up to the framework to take care of it. Okay? So for that, the code that we have that generates the SOAP message is known as SOAP node, SOAP node, right? I'll write down that term over here. Fine. So web services need to rely on physical communication medium to process and manage the message exchange. Fine. So the programs that is used by the service to transmit and receive the SOAP message are known as SOAP nodes. And SOAP nodes are part of your web service framework, right? So you don't have to write the code for that. Your web service will automatically inform the SOAP node whenever a message is supposed to be sent. Okay? So that is known as a SOAP node. Are you clear with this term? What is SOAP node? Yes. So we are decoupling two kinds of logic, right? Service logic and message generation logic. Okay, so that is the essence. Fine. Okay, so let us continue. What are the types of SOAP nodes possible? Right, so this is the structure, actual structure. A service calls the SOAP node, right? And then the SOAP node sends the SOAP message. So what do you think? How many types of SOAP nodes we can have? Okay, one or many. There are two options. Janelle said one. What about others? Can I classify this SOAP node as a requester node according to roles? What you can see on this slide is called as a requester. Yes or no? Right, because it is generating or sending a message. Similarly, can I have the you can say intermediary SOAP node? Again, would you agree to that? One, because it just translates object to primitive. Yes, yes. In that sense, it is one generally. I got your point. But if you think in terms of service roles, then can we have one SOAP node for every service role? One SOAP node for every service role. So if I want to assign some name, some unique name to this node, can I say that this is requester node, Janil? This is requester node because it is sending a message. So the logic is same. Yes, I agree with you, but just the name is different. Are you getting? Right? Okay. So based on that, we have five different classifications, right? First is SOAP sender. It is a node that transmits the message. Okay. Second is a SOAP receiver that receives the message. Okay. Third is intermediary that receives and transmits a message. Okay. So it is doing two jobs. Fourth one is initial SOAP sender. Do you remember that initial requester and ultimate provider? Yes. Those two roles. So similarly, can we say that we can have two more roles, initial SOAP sender and ultimate SOAP receiver attached to that particular web service? Yes or no? Right. So as we have five service roles, we are having five types of nodes. Can you map this now? Janil, are you fine with this? Yes. So the logic will be same, just we are identifying the names as different. Okay. Yes. Okay. Next, let us take an example. Invoice submission service has a SOAP sender node, right? Because it is the sender of the message. Okay. Now, the message goes over to the network and it is received by the SOAP receiver node. And then SOAP receiver will deliver that to the actual service. This is how the actual transmission takes place. Up till now, whatever diagrams we saw, we had web service to web service connection with a SOAP message, but we assumed that SOAP nodes are present inside. Okay. So is this diagram clear to all? Right. Like this, you can draw the diagram with intermediaries also. Is that fine? Right. Okay. Now, what are intermediaries? Right. So if you remember last time, we had defined two intermediary services, active and passive. Similar to that, over here, we have forwarding intermediary node and active intermediary node, right? So let us see, what do we mean by forwarding? Forwarding is just going to relay, right? It will just pass on the message to the next node. Okay, that is the definition. If required, it can alter the block also. So we are adding one capability, right? But this alteration is just for removal of the unwanted blocks. Removal of the unwanted blocks. As I gave you the example last time, suppose you ask the load balancer service to check the authentication information. And once the service is authenticated, you remove that username and password header. So can I say that that is forwarding intermediary? It is just removing the header, which is no longer required. Yes. So that kind of node is known as forwarding. It can just take out the header. It cannot add a new header, remember. Okay. Neither it can change the header details if required. Okay. So who is assigned that role? It is the role of active intermediary. It can alter the header block by adding new ones, right? So if required, it can insert a new header. It can change the existing headers again if required. and it can also execute certain actions. So like if you want to navigate your message based on the header, right? Suppose your header contains the ID of account service, then the message should be sent to the account service. And if the header contains ID of the some other service, let us say ledger service, then the message should be sent to ledger service. Can I say that this is called execution of logic? By checking the header, I will decide where my message should go. Are you getting? So that can be done using active intermediary node. Okay. So definitely according to programming, which nodes are complex to code or which nodes will have complex logic? Yes. Which kind of nodes will have complex logic? Forwarding or active? Obviously active, right? So in general, we have five types of nodes, right? Initial SOAP sender, ultimate SOAP receiver, SOAP sender and SOAP receiver, right? And SOAP intermediary. One more question. Can I say that initial SOAP sender is also a SOAP sender? Initial SOAP sender is also a SOAP sender. Yes or no? If it is the first web service or first node that is generating the message, right? Can I classify that as a SOAP sender also? Yes or no? So that is depicted over here. Yes, first SOAP sender. I think this diagram will make you clear, right? You can see this. SOAP sender is defined as a node, but it is also known as SOAP initial sender. All of you are clear with this now? With my question that I asked, right? Okay. SOAP intermediary can change roles. Initially, it is acting as a receiver, then it becomes a sender. Okay. And then finally, the message goes to the SOAP receiver. Okay. That is known as ultimate SOAP receiver also. So this is the actual transmission medium. This is how the message is transmitted. Now, can I say that I am following a particular message path over here? That is, my path starts from SOAP sender, then it goes to intermediary, and then it goes to SOAP receiver. Can I say that I am following a message path? Or in other words, is my message going to a particular path which is defined? Yes or no? Is the question clear? Yes, right? So, next definition or next term is message path. So, what is message path? It refers to the route taken by a message from where it is first sent until it arrives at ultimate destination. So, who will send it first? Who will send the message first? Which node? If you remember the node types, which will be the node that will first send the message? Yes. Initial sender or SOAP sender? Initial sender. That's correct. Right. And what is called ultimate destination? Ultimate receiver. Yes. Right. Like we said over here. Okay. So in between, whatever you have, that is called a message path. In between whatever nodes that your message passed through, that is your message path. Okay. So what message path contains? It contains at least one initial sender, okay, one ultimate receiver, and zero or more intermediaries. Do you agree with this second statement? Yes or no? You have one initial sender, one ultimate receiver, and zero or more intermediaries. Okay. We can also have message path dynamic if you keep that information in the SOAP message, right? That is, as I told you, if this condition is true, the message should go to X service. If this condition is false, the message should go to Y service. Okay. So based on that, your message path can also be dynamic. Okay. So this is an example of message path. Are you all clear up to this? What is message path? Right. Remember, message path is not static in case of SOA. It can be dynamic. Okay. See, you can see this. This is an example of dynamic message path, right? First intermediary service will decide either the message should follow the upward path or the bottom path, right? So based on that, your path will be decided. Okay. So message path can be dynamic in summary. Okay. So we have covered three important topics in this chapter: WSDL, SOAP, and UDDI. I just want to verify, are you all clear with this, up to this? Right? Because this is the base of SOA, right? If you don't know what is WSDL clearly, if you don't know what is SOAP or even UDDI, we will not be able to cover other topics in detail, right? So just make sure that you are clear with all, right? So chapter number 5, we have completed. Right, from the textbook Thomas Earle. I am following the textbook of Thomas Earle, right? WSDL, SOAP and UDDI is a part of chapter number 5. Okay, so that is finishing over here. Now I am going back to chapter number 4, where we are going to discuss comparison between various architectures, right? So basically in history, we have had the architectures like client server, right? We have had the architecture like distributed architecture, right? Or you can also say that we have had the architecture like hybrid web services architecture, right? So these are the three popular designs that have come up in past. So when you want to design SOA, right? How will you make sure that your SOA is different from them, right? Even whenever you will be joining any company at that time, if you are given a project, let us say, and you are asked to convert the current client server architecture in form of service oriented architecture, so you should know the clear difference. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Yes or no? Okay, so that comparison should be clear in your mind, right? So we are going to compare all the architectures with SOA to make sure that you know what is exactly SOA, how it differentiates from others. Is that clear what I'm saying? Yes or no? Okay, so that's what we'll start now. So chapter number 4 I'm beginning. In chapter 4, we have some basic theory first, and then we'll start with the comparison. So let us first finish with that basic theory. So in you can say entire world, there are a number of organizations that provide you standards, right? You are already aware with W3C, right? You are using HTML, CSS, JavaScript, right? Who has designed those standards, or who has approved them as standards? Yes, it is W3C. That's correct. Right. But when we are studying SOA, we should know that whatever standards we are using, who has provided them. Right. So I've just kept one basic slide for that. So W3C also provides the fundamental standards of SOA like XML, XML schema, WSDL, SOAP, and etc. Right. Do you know which version of XML we are using at present? Yes, it is 1.0. Yes, we write 1.0. That's correct. Similarly, XML schema also has a version. When you design XSD in your Visual Studio, did you realize that? What is the version it is defining? You can check it out later, right? Again, WSDL has come up in different versions, 1.0 and 1.1, right? 1.1 is latest. Similar to that, SOAP also has versions, right? But who governs this versions? It is W3C. Fine. Another standard that is known as OSS has given, or another organization, in other words, has given the standards like UDDI, WS Security, WSBPEL. These will be studying in chapter number 7. WS Security is a standard. It is important to encrypt the SOAP messages. We should not leave the information encrypted, right? So that is, we'll be covering in chapter 7. BPEL is a context management framework. The full form is Business Process Execution Language. Business Process Execution Language. It is also called Workflow Management. Have you heard of this term at least? Workflow Management. Anywhere? Yes? Anyone has heard this name? Don't worry, if you have not heard, we'll be covering that in detail, right? So, WSBPEL targets workflow management as a topic, right? What is the full form of OSS? It is Organization for Advancement of Structured Information Standard. Structured Information Standard, right? That is the complete name. Next is WSI. That's I stands for interoperability, right? That has given the standard like WS Basic Profile, right? So you can just Google for that. What is Basic Profile? Right? I'm not going in detail right now. Basic Profile is actually a combination of multiple standards in turn, right? So in terms of tree, you can say that it is a parent that contains a number of standards, okay? So the full form of WSI is Web Services Interoperability Organization. Just remember this terms as a computer engineer, because when you will be working with website or web service architectures, you will come across these terms. Okay, is that okay? Understood? What is the goal of each and every standard? Yes? Okay, so I guess that you are clear. Let us continue. So now I'll start with what are the different types of architectures we are having, right? And based on those types, these subtypes have been derived. Based on these basic types, these subtypes have been derived. Okay, so the basic types are divided in three categories: application architecture, enterprise architecture. Actually, two categories only. Right? Application and enterprise. If I give you a simple example of application architecture, whenever the construction team starts to build the or starts to construct the building, what they should have on their hands? Imagine you are constructing a 20-story building. What you must have? A plan, yes. Or can I say blueprint? That blueprint has the dimensions as well as the lengths and widths and everything, right? So similar to that, when we create the architecture of one particular software, right, that is called application architecture, okay? So it includes the requirements of your system. It includes the long-term and short-term goals. That is what you want to achieve by doing this, right? So basically, application architecture is targeting only one application. Right, like a blueprint targets one building. Are you able to relate this? Yes or no? Application architecture targets only one particular application. It is not for all applications across the world. Understood this much? Yes? Okay. So can you tell me what should be enterprise architecture then? Are you going to have only one application? Are you going to have only one application in any enterprise? No. It will be a collection of multiple applications. So can I say that enterprise architecture is a collection of multiple application architectures? Enterprise architecture is a collection of multiple application architectures, right? In terms of the same non-technical example, can I say that instead of having individual blueprint, if I'm having the plan of entire city, so that plan of entire city, can we compare with enterprise architecture? Are you getting the analogy that I'm following? Just to clarify, right? So that is what is enterprise architecture. Let us look at the definition. Enterprise architecture controls different application architectures. Okay. It is like an urban plan for a city. Okay. It is not a short-term goal. It is a long-term vision how the organization plans to evolve its environment. Okay. So now the question is, where SOA can be applied? Can we apply SOA to only a single application level, or can we apply it at enterprise level? What is your opinion? I have cleared out both the things, right? Yes, it can be applied to single application. That is correct. Anyone else would like to say some different answer? First on enterprise. Yes, so first you will be applying SOA at application level. General, I think you are getting, and then enterprise or reverse. Okay, you are saying reverse. Okay. So my question was, can we apply it to only application architecture or only enterprise architecture or to both? Now specify your answer clearly. Yes, General has given both as the answer. What about others? SOA actually spans enterprise architecture, as well as it also covers application architecture, as General has said. Yes, General, I hope you are clear with this. Your answer is correct, right? Yes, so SOA does not have any limitation. We cannot say that we design SOA for only single application. We design ideally the SOA for enterprise, and then we try to apply it for application level, as General has written, right? So this is the scope of SOA. It spans both the enterprise architecture and application architecture. Yes, you can have intermediate routers or intermediate designs. That's correct, right? SOA belongs in those areas that have most to gain from the features and characteristics. That means SOA tries to cover all the characteristics of your enterprise, not only one subset. It targets all the features of entire enterprise. Okay. So it is having a wide scope. That is what I wanted to convey. Are you clear up to this, all of you? What is the scope of SOA? If someone asks you, what can be a single answer? Yes. What can be a single answer? It can span across the enterprise, right? Or it can also span for a single application. Is that correct? Yes or no? Yes. Okay. Fine. Now let us go to some history and let us revise what is client server architecture, right? How client server architecture works. Let us begin with that point, right? So earlier, when the systems were very new, right, client were called dumb client, as you can see over here. Now, why they are dumb? Can you tell me by looking at the diagram? Yes, just send a request. That's correct, right? So it was not having any logic actually, right? It was just having, in the box you can see what is written, which kind of logic it contains. What kind of logic it contains? Presentation logic. So it will just display the output and it will just accept the input. That's it. Okay. So those client kind of clients are called dumb clients. Are you clear with this? What do we know as a dumb client, right? In terms of technical details, they are also called thin clients. Thin means we have minimum logic, right? So as we are having minimum logic, it will take minimum time to process as well. Yes or no? It will take minimum time to process that logic. It has to just take the input, pass on that input to the server. Okay. So on the server side, we had a combination of presentation plus business and data. What do you mean by business logic? What do you mean by business logic? Rules. Correct. Right. Business rules. If condition is true, will you follow X? Or will you follow Y? Those kind of rules you'll be defining, right? Okay. Plus data. right? So your database logic was also part of your server, right? So that is why the server was known as intelligent server. It was not dumb server. All the application logic was part of your server, right? Plus, it had to do bulk of processing. So due to that, what is the major issue that you might face? Can anyone tell me? If we are going with such a design, simple client server, what problem you might face? Too much load, that's correct. Correct, right? Or can I say that it is a single point failure system? Yes, Preet. I was going to come to that point, right? So that is where the client server actually failed. Okay. So then the people decided that instead of having single tier client server, let us move to two tier, right? Let us move to two tier. So can you observe the difference? What is over here? Then the previous slide. Can you point out the major difference? Yes. That means you are actually deploying your software on the client side, like you are running an EXE, right? You install your system on the client side. On the server side, you just have your database. Are you following this? This is called two-tier. This is called two-tier application. Yes, you send the process data to server. So what will be the server's role over here just? To manage your data. Are you all following this? Right? Okay, so this is known as two-tier client-server architecture, right? And later on, this extended to multi-tier. But then also, the problem remained same. Okay, so in this case, the client, as you know, it was thin client earlier, now it becomes fat, right? Because it is maintaining presentation logic plus business logic, as if you are installing your application itself on multiple client machines, okay? So bulk of logic resides on the client side, and it has to do bulk of processing. Communication, it exposes business logic to client. Yes, yes, General. So business logic is actually embedded as a part of stored procedures. You have studied stored procedures, right? So stored procedures were used to store the business logic, right? So wherever client required some rule, it used to call the stored procedure. And that stored procedure used to return the business logic. Are you following that? Yes? In database, there is a concept of stored procedure, right? I hope you have studied that, right? Yes, yes. Okay, so we can say that business logic partially resides on the client and partially on the server, right? That is the correct way to say that. General, is that fine? Okay, okay. What is there on database? It was purely known as database server. It was no longer known as app server or web server. It was known as database server. That's it. Because actually web technology was not there at that point of time, right? The logic was data related logic, and it was also maintaining some business rules in form of stored procedures, as I said. It was doing data related processing, and it was maintaining one connection per user. Okay, so you had to open the connection, then you need to close it when the reply comes back, right? So what kind of communication this is called? When we are sending a request by opening a connection and we are waiting for the reply, which kind of connection this is called or communication? The answer is there in the slide. Not exactly stateless, it is synchronous communication, right? Request and reply. Are you getting, General? It is request and reply, right? So in earlier client server days, in two-tier systems, they were supporting only synchronous communication because you were firing in a database query and that query was responding you with the results, right? So that's why it was called synchronous communication. Are you all clear with this design? Yes? Okay, I covered two architectures, right? Remember, single tier, two-tier. What is major difference? In single tier, client is a very lightweight machine, right? In two-tier, client has a bulk of logic. That is a major difference, okay? Server is just a database server over here, while in previous case, server was complex, Okay. Now, this model, I want to compare with service-oriented architecture. I want to compare two-tier CS or two-tier client server with SOA. So, can we go for that now? Yes, detailed comparison. Yes or no? Okay. Thanks. So, let us now start with that comparison. So, we can compare these two architectures by having five criteria. So, what are the five criteria, right, or comparison points? The first is application logic. So, how application logic is stored, that is one point of difference. Application processing, that means how your logic executes and where it executes, right? How your logic executes and where it executes. That's what we'll see in detail. Technology, which programming languages, which database providers we are going to use, right? That is again a comparison. What kind of security we require in client server and what kind of security we require in SOA. That's what we can compare. And what are the administrative overheads in both the cases? Okay, so are you clear with the 5 points at least so that we can go ahead, right? Yes, so these are the differentiating points across the architectures. Fine, let us start with the first one. Application logic. Client server places the majority application logic in the client server. We have just seen this, yes or no? We keep the presentation plus some business logic in the client side. Yes or no, in case of two-tier. Remember that, right? Can we say the same about SOA? In SOA, are we storing the entire logic in one side or in one service only? Yes or no? Are we storing the entire logic only on one side? No, right? We distribute the logic across multiple services, right? So any software capable of SOAP message exchange can be a requester. So we are not defining that this is a client, this is a server. It is not like that, right? Even the same service can act as a requester as well as provider. Same service can act as requester as well as provider, okay? That is the first point. Second point is client server stores business rules in form of stored procedures, right? In case of SOA, there is no rule, right? We can divide the logic properly or we can divide the business logic itself in multiple services. Okay, so it is not necessary that only one service should maintain the business logic. Okay, are you all clear with the first and second points? At least someone respond so that I can know that you are listening, right? Yes, Janil, Preet, Abhi, okay, Arsh, okay, thank you. Third point, client server has tight coupling. Now, can anyone tell me why it is tight coupling in case of client server? Yes, the answer is in this figure. Where is tight coupling? We are sending a message or we are sending a request, and until you are getting the response, you will remain connected? Yes, correct, right? So you are maintaining synchronous communication. So you wait for the reply basically, and that is going to increase the coupling, yes or no? That is going to increase the coupling, right? While in case of SOA, we emphasize loose coupling. Okay, so this is the third point of difference according to application logic, okay? Let us move to the second. Application processing. So how your logic executes, in other words, okay? In client server, we are having 80-20 ratio. So most of the processing is going to be done on the client side because clients is a thick client or a fat client, okay? Server is just responsible for maintaining your data. So it is going to do 20% processing, okay? Do we have the same situation in SOA? Can we say that one service is doing 80% of the job and the other is doing 20%? Can we say that? No, right? So what is the similar point we can say? In SOA, we have distributed processing. No fixed processing ratio. I cannot define a number, actually, right? Okay. The second difference is, for processing the logic, we use synchronous communication, right? While in case of SOA, we use synchronous or asynchronous, right? Both ways. Fine. Client-server applications tend to be stateful, while over here in SOA, we tend to be stateless because we store the information of state in the message. That is known as message-level context management. Okay. Regarding the resources, client requires most of the resources because, see, you are going to deploy your system on every client machine, right? You will be installing your system specially, right? You will be running the EXE on every client machine, right? So, a lot of resources are required on the client side. But in case of SOA, the resource requirement can also be distributed. We cannot say that one side requires maximum resources. So, are you clear up to this? This comparison point? Yes? Okay. So, you should be able to compare point by point, right? In textbook, if you will see, they have given paragraph by paragraph comparison, but I've just tried to compare point by point so that you can easily remember and you can answer. Okay. So, let us continue. Technology. This is very simple comparison. In client server, we use third generation programming languages like C++ or fourth generation basic languages like VB, right? While in case of SOA, we are using advanced fourth generation languages like Java, C#, right? And others, right? Or you are also using web technologies plus XML, JSON, all those things, right? Database applications were robust RDBMS like Oracle and Microsoft for client server. In current situation, we are using either a web-based database or cloud-based database, right? You might also be using JSON-based data storage, right? So we are using actually latest versions, right? That's what we can say. Clear with this slide? Technology-based comparison. Yes. So let us move forward if you are clear. Security. In case of client server, we require security on both the ends, right? We have to secure the client machine because on the client's machine, you are going to install your system, right? So you require username and password on client side, as well as when you are accessing database, you require the authentication of database server. Okay. So in case of client server, security is required on both the ends, right? What about SOA? In case of SOA, security requirements are complex because your messages have to be encrypted, right? Your services will require authentication, right? Suppose it is a B2B communication, business to business. So every service that is exposing the logic outside must have authentication. Fine. So actually in SOA, security will be more in focus because it is going to be complex. Okay. So this is about security. Let us now focus last on administration. In case of client server, whenever you change something, you have to update on every client machine, right? You have to update on every client machine. So every update has to go to each and every client. Okay. Plus, you have to maintain your database server, right? While in case of SOA, the challenge is we have to handle variety of requester because your requester can be a mobile device. It can be an application. It can be a web service, right? So as an administrator, you should be ready to handle any types of requester. Plus, you have to handle composition of services. You have to manage the UDDIs, right? So many things. So again, I would say SOA is complex in terms of administration. Are you clear with all these points of comparison? Yes? Okay, so just go through the slides. I'll upload the slides by tomorrow, right? If you still have any query, we can discuss that. Okay? Fine. So let us end this session. Have a good day ahead.